They were mothers, secretaries, housewives. No one expected they would help win a war.
These are years when few women even had driver's licenses.
There was not a single type of airplane that was deployed in World War II that some woman didn't fly.
I'd have flown those airplanes for free.
Fly Girls, tonight on The American Experience. Major funding for The American Experience is provided by the annual financial support of PBS viewers like you and by the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation to enhance public understanding of the role of technology. The foundation also supports the Sloan Technology Series, a collection of books chronicling the major technologies of the 20th century.
Each American experience is made possible by Liberty. Liberty Mutual Insurance.
And by Miracle-Gro Plant Foods. For flowers, for vegetables, for a beautiful show, for lawns and for shrubs. Whatever you grow, a gardener's true friend is Miracle-Gro.
Hello, I'm David McCullough. Welcome to the American Experience. They numbered little more than 1,000, and until the emergency, they had been doing mostly what women were expected to do then. They were wives, mothers, waitresses, secretaries, librarians, dancers, socialites, college students. And like their male counterparts, they had come of age during the Great Depression, when jobs of almost any kind were few and very hard to get. But it was the early 1940s, the height of the Second World War, and a call went out such as had never been made before. They volunteered in an experimental Army Air Corps program to see if women could serve as pilots for the military, to release male pilots for combat. Fly Girls, our film, is a subject as pertinent today as it was more than 50 years ago. From the vantage point of the present day, the concerns and biases they had to overcome seem absurd. But the worry that women might not be physically capable of flying military aircraft was very real. With the fiercely determined leadership of Jackie Cochran, one of the most famous pilots of the time, the experiment succeeded beyond all expectations. These pioneer aviators proved they could do the job and then some. This is a wonderful story, told largely by the women themselves. And one further point. In 1977, 33 years after they were disbanded, the WASPs, the Women Air Force Service Pilots of World War II, finally achieved full military recognition when President Jimmy Carter signed a law making them officially veterans. Fly Girls by producer Laurel Ladovich.
In those days, we didn't have movie heroes. We didn't have rock star heroes. We had the aviators who were pushing back technology, who were doing fantastic things as pioneers. My family would go to the airport every Sunday afternoon, and we would watch the airplanes and look at all of the activity. And that was our standard Sunday afternoon.
Well, I wasn't even of school age. I'm 5 years old, and I saw something go across high in the sky, and I didn't know what it was. So I went into my mother and I said, "Mother, there's something out there and I want you to get it for me. I want to play with it." I sort of forgot about this, but it was always back there cooking in my subconscious. I got all the way into college and I still hadn't flown.
Amelia Earhart came to speak to our school. I was in the front row, and she came forward and stood right in front of me, and I felt she was looking right down at me.
Remember, these are years when few women even had driver's licenses. It's not a time where little girls growing up thought, one day I'll fly military airplanes.
Between 1942 and 1944, at the height of World War II, More than 1,000 women left homes and jobs for the opportunity of a lifetime, to become the first in history to fly for the United States military. But the opportunity came at a price. They faced danger and discrimination, and 38 women would die in the line of duty.
This is Texas, cradle of our Army's Air Force. This is an AAF field, too. But over headquarters rides a strange little girl gremlin called Fifinella. And out of those buses are stepping girls. Girls who give a new angle to an Air Force story. They're WASPs, Women's Air Force Service Pilots.
On we go into the wild blue yonder, climbing high into the sun. Here they come, zooming to meet our thunder. Adam, boys, give her the gun, give her the gun. Down we go, spouting our flame from under. Off with one hell of a roar. We live in fame, or we're down in flame. Ain't nothing will stop the Air Force now.
The Women's Air Force Service Pilots were the vision of America's most accomplished female flyer, Jacqueline Cochran. Born Bessie Mae Pittman somewhere in the South, she claimed to be an orphan raised by a foster family and to have gone to work in a textile factory at the age of 8. As a teenager, she learned the beauty trade and headed north. On her way to New York City, she picked a new name out of a phone book. Jacqueline Cochran would make herself up as she went along. I might have been born in a hovel, she recalled, but I was determined to travel with the wind and the stars. At the exclusive Saks Fifth Avenue Beauty Salon, Cochran's clients were wealthy and powerful. Through them, she met the man who would change her life. Floyd Odlum, a financier 15 years her senior, was one of the richest men in America.
I think what she got when she married Floyd, I think, was an opening door for her, because what she saw was the opportunity not only to have drive and initiative, but to use power.
Odlum supported Cochran's ambition, helping her to establish her own cosmetics company, and he encouraged her to fly. Flying would become her passion. In just 10 years, Jackie Cochran would capture 17 world records. With the disappearance of Amelia Earhart in 1937, Cochran became America's most prominent female aviator. In 1938, she won the most prestigious air race in the world, the Transcontinental Bendix. And she received the Harmon Trophy for Outstanding Female Aviator from First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt.
Basically, she was very aggressive. If she wanted something, she knew how to get it. And she was a very clever gal, and she's also an outstanding pilot.
Jackie Cochran was one of those people, when I grew up in my house, had the kind of status that Jimmy Doolittle had. People in my family have always respected people who have tenacity of purpose. And Jackie Cochran had tenacity of purpose.
Cochran was enormously energetic and enormously driven. She also had the temperament of seeing everything in the world in terms of black and white, right or wrong, win or lose.
In 1939, when Great Britain declared war on Germany, Jackie made a bold recommendation to Eleanor Roosevelt that American women pilots could serve in a national emergency. Eleanor agreed that women pilots were a weapon waiting to be used. 2 years later, as America moved closer to war, Cochrane took her idea to Hap Arnold, chief of the Army Air Forces. Arnold suggested that she observe the role women pilots were playing ferrying aircraft throughout Great Britain. Cochrane recruited 24 American women to fly for the British.
Today I have seen the most magnificent thing that I ever hoped to see, a very large group of women, and they are doing a job and the most diversified work that I've ever seen done by women.
It was Cochrane's understanding that if an American program was needed, it would be hers to command.
The Japanese have attacked Pearl Harbor, Hawaii by air, President Roosevelt has just announced.
After Pearl Harbor, aircraft production soared from 19,000 planes in 1941 to 48,000 in 1942. Thousands of airplanes needed to be moved from factories to air bases and for shipment overseas. With male pilots being sent to combat duty, there was a severe shortage of pilots at home. In September 1942, Jackie Cochrane prepared to return from England, ready to start her own program. But another accomplished aviator was one step ahead. Nancy Love had been quietly lobbying for a select group of experienced women pilots to begin ferrying military aircraft. On September 10th, Love's program was announced.
WAFS, Women's Auxiliary Ferrying Squadron, report to Nancy Harkness Love, their commander, at Newcastle, Delaware. They'll deliver planes to the Army. Although they wear uniform costumes and are trained by Army officers, they have civil service status, not military, and the pay is $3,000 a year. They'll be used in domestic service only. There are only a few WAFS just now, but their ranks are increasing, and every one releases a man flyer for combat duty.
Jackie Cochrane is returning from Britain that very day, and she picks up the newspapers, looks at the headlines, which announce the formation of this squadron, and she's outraged.
Cochrane stormed into Hap Arnold's office and demanded an explanation. She emerged with her own training program. Not for a select few, but for thousands of women pilots. 10 months later, Nancy Love's WAFS and Jackie Cochrane's trainees merged to become the Women Air Force Service Pilots, known as the WASP. Although the two women were supposed to share command, Cochrane maneuvered to become director of the entire program.
Would you like to swing on a star, carry moonbeams home in a jar, and be better off than you are? Or would you rather be a mule? You can be better than you are. You could be swinging on a star.
During the course of the WASP program, 25,000 women applied. 1,830 women with flying experience were accepted. They were housewives and mothers, co-eds and farm girls, socialites, secretaries, even actresses. One of the first women recruited, Cornelia Fort, was from a prominent family in Nashville, Tennessee. Although her father made his three sons promise not to fly, it never occurred to him his daughter would become a pilot.
I can't say exactly why I fly, but I know why, as I've never known anything in my life. I know it in dignity and self-sufficiency and in the pride of skill.
Barbara B.J. Erickson was a home economics major at the University of Washington and an instructor for military pilots.
I got one of the letters and was told that if I wanted to go at my own expense back to Wilmington, Delaware, they would check my records, my logbooks. I would take a physical, could take a flight check, and if I was successful, I would be one of the 25 that they were going to select.
A barnstormer known for her 26 consecutive spins, Teresa James was instructing male pilots in aerobatics when she received her recruitment letter.
Maybe 30 minutes I thought about it and decided to hop a train and go to Wilmington, Delaware.
Dora Doherty was in her junior year at Northwestern University in Evanston, Illinois, when she read about the program in the Chicago Tribune.
I went to take my physical exam, and of course there were thousands of men there taking physical exams. The halls were lined with men. Every room that you looked in, men in there in various states of dress. And when I got to where I was supposed to have my physical, my pulse was so fast that they said I didn't qualify. Well, what's a young 21-year-old girl to do when she is walking through a hotel full of men?
After graduating from Smith College, Anne Baumgartner moved to New York City and became a writer for the New York Times.
I had done a lot of other adventurous things, mountain climbing, training horses, and things like that. And that just seemed like the next step.
Madge Rutherford was finalizing her wedding plans to Sherman Minton when she received a telegram.
And I dropped everything and got Sherman on the phone and said, "Sherman, the wedding's off in April. We can get married after I finished my training at Sweetwater, Texas."
Marty Martin turned down a graduate fellowship at the University of Michigan in order to become a WASP. But as she was preparing to leave home, she received a telegram that her physical had not been sent.
And I called up the flight surgeon at Stout Field, and I really was upset. I said, "You've ruined my whole life. I've waited so long to get in this, and you didn't send in my form." And he listened for a long time, and finally he said, "Young lady, you don't speak to colonels like this." So I said, "I'm sorry, but I'm really upset about this." And he said, "I will send it in. But I don't think women should be in the military."
As the site for WASP training, Jackie Cochran chose Avenger Field in Sweetwater, Texas. To her, it was ideal. Wide open, dry, and isolated.
The first night that we were there, we were in a new barracks. We didn't talk about engines, we didn't talk about airplanes, we didn't talk about men, we talked about snakes. Every type of poisonous snake that's found in our country is found in the state of Texas.
The only thing that was bad about Sweetwater were the spiders, tarantulas, and black widows.
But even before they get a chance to take the polish off their nails, it's out onto a dusty Texas drill field with them. Right away, the Air Force wants to get a little muscle on those pretty arms. This scene provides a pretty fair picture of what the girls look like from all angles. None of them are under 21 or over 35.
From sunup to sundown, a trainee's day was consumed by aviation. Jackie Cochran insisted the women receive the same training as male Army Air Force pilots. 200 hours of flight instruction and 400 hours of ground school, including physics, navigation, flight theory, instruments, and Morse code. Accommodations were basic. 6 women were assigned to a room, and 12 women shared a single bath.
No privacy, none at all. We just learned to live together.
A cockpit check involves 29 duties, and to remember them all is terrifically hard and confusing. Three more girls washed out last week. It's getting rougher here.
One in three women didn't make it, washing out of the program. It was a number consistent with male cadets.
The demerits didn't scare me as much as washing out, because that was the worst thing that could happen to you. And before evening, you were gone. Your bedroll was all rolled up. Your clothes were all gone. No note, no nothing.
Those who made it through the 6 months of training received their silver wings from Jackie Cochran, who flew in from her headquarters at the Pentagon.
Graduates now, they're members of the Women's Air Force Service Pilots, fearless as falcons and twice as fast. And in their new and unusual occupation, these modern girls are still the feminine heirs to a noble tradition of pioneering strength and courage. Off they go to be conveyed to other ferry stations or to factories in the continental United States in order that they may deliver new fighter and trainer planes to masculine fighting hands. Stronger hands, perhaps, but no more valiant than those of their sisters, the WASP.
We did the same thing that any other ferry command guy would have done. There's no other place in the military that you flew the variety of airplanes that you did in the ferry command. If you went into a fighter unit or into any other unit in the Army Air Corps, you stuck with that kind of an airplane. But in the ferry command, you had to fly whatever was out there and had to be moved, so we did get a terrific variety.
I don't have the exact statistics, but it is said that there was not a single type of airplane that was deployed in World War II that some woman didn't fly.
Women were assigned to air bases throughout the country. When 25 WASP arrived at Camp Davis in North Carolina, they found 50,000 men on base. Fresh from the confines of Cochran's convent, the women dubbed it Wolf Swamp.
And Jacqueline Cochran, in all her wisdom, said, girls, I think that maybe you should not date too much until you get to know people. So in the telephone, in the hallway of our barracks, I remember there was a list. Date him, don't date him. And if you came back from a date where you didn't think that this was an appropriate person that you would like your friends to date, his name got on the list.
I was at the officers' club, but I wasn't in uniform. And they were having a party there, and these B-47 pals, they were going overseas. So I was dancing with this guy, and he was telling me about, oh, this aircraft, and blah, blah, and, you know, can't we get together, you know, and the old story, hey, I'm going away to war kind of thing. And I says, well, what kind of an airplane is it? And he went on to regale me with his big engine, and you know what could happen on if it quits on takeoff and all this stuff. So the next morning, go into operations, I'm in my flight suit, and I'm writing up the manifest. And that guy did a double take. I thought he was going to drop dead. After all these stories that he told me about this P-47, he didn't, no idea that I was a P-47 pilot.
No hopes of replacing men pilots. But we can each release a man to combat to overseas work. Delivering a trainer to Texas may be as important as delivering a bomber to Africa if you take the long view. Cornelia Fort.
By mid-1943, WASPs were ferrying aircraft throughout the United States, often under difficult conditions. They flew 7 days a week and had to be ready for anything. Teresa James left one morning on a ferry trip that was to take a day. 17,000 miles, 6 airplanes, and 30 days later, she returned to base.
So I had a tan shirt and my gray slacks on, and that was it.
We never knew on a trip whether we were going to be in a single-engine airplane or a twin-engine airplane, or whether we were going to be have room to carry stuff or not.
There was no such thing as wash and wear. It was just a plain shirt that I washed at and hung up at night, and it was just wrinkles. It had no resemblance to a shirt.
But we managed. You know, you can wear a pair of pants a long time.
You should have seen my slacks. My knees bulged. You could actually put cantaloupes in them. I met B.J. Erickson, and I asked, does she have an extra pair of slacks? She says, no. She says, God, James, you look like the wrath of God.
And we finally figured out that most of the airplanes had compartments in the wings where they put the bullets, and they were empty, so we could put a high heel shoe out there in each one of them.
Finally got back to the base. I was gone 30 days. And I said, never again will I ever trust the Army when they say, just a short trip out and back.
The attitude that most non-flyers have about pilots is distressing and often acutely embarrassing. They chatter about the glamour of flying. Well, any pilot can tell you how glamorous it is. We get up in the cold dark in order to get to the airport by daylight. We wear heavy, cumbersome flying clothes and a 30-pound parachute. You're either hot or cold. You look forward all afternoon to the bath you will have and the steak. Sometimes we are too tired to eat and fall wearily into bed. Cornelia Fort.
As the WASP proved successful, their assignments expanded beyond ferrying into more dangerous areas. They became test pilots, flight instructors, and were even assigned to tow targets for artillery training using live ammunition.
We would fly up and down the beach, and they would either track us or shoot at us or whatever the mission called for. The gunfire never hit the fuselage, to my knowledge. I may have gotten my first few gray hairs there, but I was not aware that I got shot.
Ann Baumgartner was sent to Wright Field in Dayton, Ohio, where the Air Force tested airplanes, equipment, even pilots to their limit.
We're approaching the speed of sound, and this was one of the tasks that they were working on, trying to get airplanes faster, would go higher, go farther for the war effort. We also went in the pressure chamber. They can take you up to 25,000 feet, and we were shown how we thought we were in grand shape at 25,000 feet, but we couldn't even spell our own names when asked. That was to show us how dangerous it was to not use oxygen over 10,000 feet. But it was a fascinating place, and fascinating things were going on there. Wonderful planes were taking off that we had known about, that we didn't know about.
Baumgartner requested a transfer to the flight test program and became the only female test pilot at Wright Field, flying alongside the Air Force's finest. In 1943, she became the only woman to pilot the Bell YP-59A, the first jet fighter.
Just on takeoff, you could hear the big roar as you were going down the runway. And then as you were airborne, there was no noise at all. I thought the engines had quit. But it was just that the noise is behind you. that plane had taken the first step in jet flight, so it was a famous airplane.
The B-29 was the largest long-range bomber ever built. Rushed through production, it was critical to America's war with Japan. After Boeing's top pilot was killed testing it, the plane acquired a dangerous reputation. Colonel Paul Tibbetts, who would later pilot the Enola Gay, was responsible for convincing pilots the B-29 was safe to fly. He would use the Wasp to make his point.
And that's where I thought, if I could train those two girls to fly, nobody had to say anything. Put those guys in the airplane with them and let them do the routine that I taught them to do.
I really didn't think that I was big enough to fly a four-engine airplane. I'd never been in one before in my life. In those days, I was 5'5". I didn't think I had a four-engine hand.
Dusenberry was going to be flight engineer. He got me off to one side when he could. He said, "What are those?" I said, "Those are two women we're going to teach to fly the airplane." And he looked at me and said, "You're going to be in the airplane, aren't you?" I said, "Yes, Dus, I'll be there." And I worked the girls hard 3 days. We flew for 7 hours a day.
And we went up and did the air work, you know, engine out procedures and stalls. And on final approach for our first landing, there was smoke coming out of number three engine.
We had a real problem with engine number three when the cockpit filled full of smoke. And Doris didn't take any instructions. She didn't hesitate 1 minute. Now, I'm sitting back beside the engineer. I'm back out of the way. I never opened my mouth. My engineer looked at me, you know, I told him, I said, "Dus, wait."
I turned to look, and Dusenberry was our flight engineer. And sure enough, and so I told him to feather number three and pull the fire extinguisher, which he did.
There's no way I would have interfered. He did everything just like the book said to do it. When I thought they were ready, I said, "Okay, we're going to go." My orders were to go to Clovis, New Mexico, where this transition school was.
And then we were supposed to take various crews up with us and show them how to fly the B-29. Well, this was an extremely interesting position because these were seasoned four-engine combat crews.
They were dumbfounded that two women would fly that airplane that way when they said it wouldn't fly. It was an amazing effect. When they went through that routine that Dora and Dede gave them, one of the men on that airplane came back, went into the operations officer, pulled off his wings. Now, these are all college football heroes, see? He pulled off his wings and threw them down on the desk of the operations officer. He said, "I'm finished. That's the end of it." This guy looked at him and said, "Lieutenant, pick up your wings. You're not finished till we tell you you're finished."
This, of course, happened in late 1944. I never thought anything more about it. And then in 1995, I received a letter that really amazed me. I couldn't believe it. The man who wrote it said, "I realize that it was a long time ago, but I still want to thank you for helping me that day at Clovis. You came to show us that the B-29 plane was not one to be feared. You were the pilot that day and demonstrated your excellent flying skills and convinced us the B-29 was a plane that any pilot would be proud to fly. From that day on, we never had a pilot who didn't want to fly the B-29.
Because there were and are so many disbelievers in women pilots, especially in their place in the Army, all of us realized what a spot we were on. We had to deliver the goods or else there wouldn't ever be another chance for women pilots in any part of the service. Cornelia Fort.
Wasps were not always welcomed at bases where they were assigned. At Camp Davis, it was clear they were not wanted. Many planes assigned to WASPs were returned from combat and in need of repair. Women pilots experienced repeated engine failures. They expressed concern that the planes were not being properly maintained.
After a pilot flies a plane, if there's something wrong, they write it down. And it's supposed to be taken off the flight line until that's fixed. Well, what they would do was not ground the plane. They'd just write what the problem was, and off it would go.
After two WASPs died and another was seriously injured within 1 month, some women began to suspect foul play. Jackie Cochran came to investigate. She would later admit finding sugar in the gas tank of one of the downed planes. To her, it was a clear indication of sabotage. But concerned that adverse publicity could jeopardize her program, she kept it quiet. There would be no official investigation of the deaths at Camp Davis.
Mabel Rawlinson's death at Camp Davis, I don't know exactly what it could be attributed to. I did not go out to the crash scene, but the fire was intense. They could not get Mabel out, and she burned. It was a very traumatic time for all of us there. I remember there was an old nurse who came over to our barracks, and she had a couple of bottles of beer, and she sat on the end of the barracks out there watching the fire, drinking her beer and singing old hymns. Nearer, my God, to thee, shall we gather at the river? And in a deep sort of whiskey tenor, and just thinking the thoughts that we all thought. Now, I think when you join the military, you obviously go through a mindset that you're prepared for something like this. This was the first time that I had seen a friend die, so it was a trauma for me, and I think for all of us.
If I die violently, who can say it was before my time? I want no one to grieve for me. I was happiest in the sky. At dawn, when the quietness of the air was like a caress, when the noon sun beat down, and at dusk, when the sky was drenched with a fading light. Think of me there, and remember me, I hope, as I shall you. With love, Cornelia.
Cornelia Fort was killed on March 21st. 1943, when a male pilot accidentally clipped her wing in midair. She had been the first woman pilot in United States history to die for her country. The families of the WASPs who died received no benefits. No flag, and no gold star to hang in their windows. The government made no provision for returning the bodies back home because the women had no official military status. The WASP themselves would contribute money when necessary to send a body home for burial. Jackie Cochran was determined to gain official military recognition for the WASP, but she wanted it on her own terms. Hap Arnold suggested the WASP militarize under the Women's Army Corps, the WACS. But only one female colonel was allowed in the Army, and that position was taken by Ovita Culp Hobby.
So if Cochran was to become part of the WAC program, she would have to be subordinate to Ovita Culp Hobby, who was the director of the WAC. She was immensely talented and capable. And Jackie Cochran hated her.
Nearly 100,000 WACs served in the Army as nurses, clerks, and drivers, but none as pilots. Convinced WASPs would be grounded if they joined the WACs, Jackie Cochran refused. And referring to Hobby, she said, "I will not serve under a woman who doesn't know her ass from a propeller." Once again, Cochran appealed to her ally, Hap Arnold. Arnold agreed to go before Congress and propose that the WASP be militarized under her command. But the timing couldn't have been worse. By early 1944, air superiority had been achieved in Europe, and American pilots began to return home. Pilot training programs in the U.S. were shut down, and civilian instructors now faced the draft, not as flyers, but as foot soldiers. But if the men could take over flying jobs held by the women, they would avoid the draft. They launched a campaign against the WASP, in the press and in Congress. Powerful columnists of the day attacked Hap Arnold, Jackie Cochran, and the WASP program. Public sentiment began to change.
There's resistance because the American public in general believed that women served a useful, noble, patriotic purpose during the war, but they couldn't envision the need after the war.
Just 6 months earlier, it had been heroic to do a man's job. But by mid-1944, it was considered unpatriotic.
Everybody was anticipating peacetime and the return to normal. People wanted to go back to an America of work, of family, of friends, of home. It didn't include mom going off to fly military planes.
Congressional hearings focused on the alleged high cost of training women pilots. Despite Hap Arnold's personal testimony and support from the War Department, the bid for WASP militarization failed. Congress recommended that all pilot training for women be stopped. They also recommended that women pilots already in service continue to fly, but without military status. But for Jackie Cochran, there could be no compromise. She compiled an exhaustive report detailing the WASP's accomplishments and released it to the press. The report revealed that the WASP had flown over 60 million miles in every type of aircraft, and that their safety and performance records were comparable to male pilots. Cochran gave Hap Arnold an ultimatum: find a way to militarize the program, including pilot training under her command, or shut it down. Arnold could no longer fight Cochran's battle. He had a war to win. In October 1944, he announced the WASP would be deactivated on December 20th. In a moving speech to the final graduating class, General Arnold acknowledged the WASP had exceeded all expectations, even his own.
"Frankly, I didn't know in 1941 whether a slip of a girl could fight the controls of a B-17 in heavy weather. Those of us who had been flying for 20 or 30 years knew that flying an airplane was something that you do not learn overnight. But Miss Cochran said that carefully selected young women could be trained to fly our combat-type planes. So it was only right that we took advantage of every skill that we as a nation possess. We can come to only one conclusion. The entire operation has been a tremendous success. It is on the record that women can fly as well as men. In training, in safety, and in operation.
When we were getting ready to be disbanded, we volunteered to do this for nothing. I'd have flown those airplanes for free.
And it was such a shock to him. It was when we know that we were needed, when we were doing most of the flying of the pursuit aircraft, you know, it was sort of silly.
When we were disbanded, the war was still on, of course. I went back to school. I had to finish my junior year at Northwestern. And I felt very strange because I was older than most of the students. They had a veterans group there, and I went to join that, and they said, you're not a veteran. You're not allowed in here.
When I was disbanded on the 20th of December, there were 60-some P-51s and P-38s sitting on the field undelivered that day. And yet all my girls got in the cars and drove home. And that was very, very sad because we were badly needed.
No time to waste. Everywhere they're badly needed for ferrying duty so that the men trained and training can go off to fight while WASPs help get their ships started on the road overseas. There is a reason for the WASPs. So long, ladies. Go to it. Someday you'll be able to sit down in the evening with your husbands, who will probably be flyers, and remind them that during the war, you did your part. Keep them flying, Fifinella.
Jackie had a dream, just like the rest of us. And it took me years to understand that. She really wanted us all to be able to fly everything just to show the men that it could be done. And I think she largely succeeded in this.
She fought for us. She fought for the concept that she believed in, that women could do this. She probably was the only person that could have done it as effectively.
It wouldn't have existed without her. Cochrane is a complicated figure. She may have had the temperament of black and white, but her own life, viewed from the perspective of history, is one of many shades of gray. It's very difficult to understand those contradictions, but it's what makes her fascinating as an individual.
Jackie Cochran remained at the Pentagon as a special consultant to Hap Arnold and was awarded the Distinguished Service Medal for her wartime service. In 1948, she finally received her military commission as Lieutenant Colonel in the U.S. Air Force Reserves. Continuing to establish new speed records, she became the first woman to break the sound barrier in 1953.
It was incredibly beautiful to be able to do what we knew we wanted to do, and we were very patriotic about it all.
It was not what they did for themselves, but how they fit in and did a job for the war effort.
And I think that what the WASP did was to reaffirm the fact that we are still the pioneer women that my grandmother represented, that we are still capable of firing the musket.
My grandfather always said that no matter what you do inside that mighty machine, from the smallest cog up, you make it run, and they help make it run. They help win that war. In the larger context, they create the legend, the precedent of what women can do. No one is ever able to say a woman cannot do a flying job or a technical job. They help make that true.
The WASP in World War II accomplished a necessary mission. Now, they could have been sent to the war had the law allowed it, and they would probably have have done as good as the men had they had equal experience.
These thoughts are something that we should contemplate when we think what the WASP did and what other women in the military have done and should do, because half of the brain power of our country is in the heads of its women. And if we don't use this to the best of our advantage, then we are the poorer for it.
I, for one, am profoundly grateful that my one talent, my only knowledge, flying, happens to be of use to my country when it is needed. That's all the luck I ever hope to have.
Follow a WASP across the country, get a close-up look at a B-29, and check out Wayback, the new online magazine for kids. The American Experience Online, www.pbs.org.
From under, off with one.